Hello everyone, myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. Today I have brought to you a lot of questions that can be of use for you. But before moving to the questions, let me tell you that you all can download this PDF via the Telegram channel of ours. The link is in description below. So let's begin with the first question. Who heads the subcommittee of the center under the Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana for suggesting suitable working models to reduce the cost of insurance premium? So guys, here the right answer is option B, Saurabh Mishra. Now before moving into the news itself, let me give you a brief about this entire news. So I hope that you all are aware of the fact that many states are withdrawing from this scheme because of the high cost that they have to bear, particularly for paying off the premiums under the scheme, and secondly for assessing the crop yield of the farmers in order to settle the claims. So in order to tackle both of these problems, the central government has created two subcommittees or group of experts. One group will look into the technologies that can be used for crop yield estimation so that the ultimate cost of estimating the crop yield of farmers can be reduced. The other group will look into the models that can be adopted by the states under this scheme, not only the states but the center as well, in order to reduce the entire cost of the premiums plus the entire structure, entire procedure that is done for paying the premiums. Okay, so the cost involved in the procedure can also be reduced, which will lead to the ultimate reduction in the final premium cost for the center and the state. So that's the brief of this news. Let's now move into the details. So I have told you this entire thing, why these committees have been created. Now the several states like Gujarat, Andhra, Telangana, Bihar, West Bengal, all of them have withdrawn from the scheme citing the high premium cost that they have to bear. So on this particular note only, I'm going to ask you the cost sharing ratio of this scheme. Do mention it in the comment section below. Next is the first committee that is going to be chaired by the ISRO scientist K.R. Manjunath. So this will look into the technologies that can be used. Now those technologies will be developed by ISRO with National Remote Sensing Center, which is a part of ISRO. Okay, Mahalanobis National Crop Forecast Center, which operates under the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare. So all of these will collaborate and develop technologies that can be used for crop yield estimation. Government is also planning to use drones as well as satellite based images for the purpose of inspection, but still it is just a plan. Second committee is chaired by Saurabh Mishra, who is the joint secretary in the Ministry of Finance. Guys, do remember this point, joint secretary in the Ministry of Finance. Recently the CEO, not very recently, but in 2021 only, the CEO of Fasal Bima Yojana was also elected, which is Ritesh Chauhan. So also remember that point. Joint secretary in the Ministry of Finance, this Saurabh Mishra is chairing this committee. Okay, and it will suggest models to reduce the premium cost. Apart from this, there is nothing much that you need to pay attention to. Okay, moving on to the second question, on which river is the Renuka G multi-purpose project being developed? So guys, here the right answer is option E, Giri, which is a tributary of Yamuna River. Do remember this fact. Now, this project, guys, the surveys related to this project began in the 1970s only, but right now the foundation stone of this project has been laid. Now, for so many years, this project has faced so many procedural delays that now is the right time for its foundation. But let's see, when will this project be completed? As far as the facts of this project are concerned, you need to know that Himachal Pradesh is the state where it will be located, where it will be developed. It is going to resolve the problem of drinking water as well as irrigation for Delhi and the NCR regions. Estimated cost of this project is this much. Center is going to bear 90% of the cost, and states now here Not only Himachal Pradesh, Delhi and NCR regions are also going to be benefited from this project. Therefore, the cost will be shared between all the states who are going to benefit from this project. I'm going to tell you the list. You have to wait for it first. But let's look at the river. Giri River, which is a tributary of Yamuna. And on this river, this dam project will be developed. Implementing agency is Himachal Pradesh Power Corporation Limited. Now, the scheme is a part of the Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sichai Yojana. Do remember this point. Now, because of this project, this scheme is in the news. So do prepare it thoroughly, because you never know when the notification of the exam will come out and you will be left with no time in your hand. So just be prepared. Don't let your guard down. Okay. Beneficiary states are Himachal, Haryana, Uttarakhand, Delhi, Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh. Okay. And this is just an information, extra information that you don't need to memorize. I just pointed out that how much delay has this project faced so far. That's all. Moving ahead, which country has launched AI prosecutor that can charge people with crime using artificial technology? So it is China. China has launched this AI prosecutor. So now you can see this person or the artificial person is going to give justice to the real person. That's how the world is changing. Who heads the Information System Security Committee of SEBI? So guys, here the right answer is option B, H. Krishnamurthy. So in the month of December only, SEBI reconstituted its 7 committees. Okay. Now I'm going to tell you all the 7 committees, the heads of those committees and the purpose of those committees. As far as the purposes are concerned, you don't have to put an extra effort because the names are very indicative of the purposes of the committees. Okay. So let's move into the details. First one is Information Systems and Security Committee headed by Professor H. Krishnamurthy. Guys, this is something that you can totally skip. Okay. So this committee approves information security policies. It also reviews the implementation of cyber security and resilience policies. It establishes mechanism for timely communication of cyber incidents to the ISSC, etc. So these are some of the purposes out of the total purposes that were mentioned on the SEBI's website that I found important and summarizing. So I have just put those points. As far as the name is concerned, it is very evident that it is for the information system and protecting the security of the information systems, the communication systems that SEBI use. Primary Market Advisory Committee, T.V. Mohandas Pai. So he was earlier the chairman of this committee. Now also he is the chairperson. No need to memorize this. Again, it provides details regarding the regulation and development of primary market in India. Not details, but recommend the measures. How can SEBI do that? And it also looks into the matters required to be taken up for changes in the legal framework to introduce simplification and transparency in the systems and procedures in the primary market. Again, very basic. Third committee is Advisory Committee on Mutual Funds. Usha Thorat is the chairperson. It advises SEBI on matters relating to the regulation of mutual funds for ensuring investor protection. Guys, can you tell me that which is this self-regulatory organization for the mutual funds in India, for regulating the mutual funds in India? High Powered Steering Committee on Cybersecurity headed by Anant Barua, and it oversees the entire cybersecurity initiatives for SEBI and the entire capital market. Okay. Next is Secondary Market Advisory Committee, Madhavi Puri Birch, and reviews the developments in the secondary market and also suggests measures to improve the overall structure of the secondary market, as well as strengthening the overall regulatory framework of the secondary market. Okay. Corporate Bond and Securitization Advisory Market headed by this G. Mahalingam, and it advises SEBI on issues relating to the development of the corporate bond market and the market for securitized instruments in India. So that was the committee. Now we have Market Data Advisory Committee headed by MS Sahu, and it recommends the policy for access to securities data for both transaction and disclosures. Identification of segment wise data parameters, completely skip. You can skip this point because nobody is going to ask you the purpose or the task or the task for with which this committee has been for which this committee has been formed. You can just memorize the head of this committee. As far as the purpose of this committee is concerned, so basic purpose of this Market Data Advisory Committee is to make the market data, first of all, accessible, and secondly, to limit what kind of data and how much data should be accessible to the investors, retail investors, institutional investors, and all kind of market stakeholders. So that's the kind of work that this committee has been tasked with. Okay. Next is, who is the author of the Modi Gambit, Decoding Modi 2.0 book? Sanju Verma is the right answer. Who has become the first Indian to win two international skiing medals? Anchal Thakur is the right answer. Okay, so guys, let me tell you that first of all, what are the things that you need to memorize from this entire news? Okay, Anchal Thakur has won the bronze medal at the Federation, the International the Sky Meet, which is basically a tournament held in Montenegro. Okay. Next is that by winning this bronze medal, Anchal Thakur has become the first Indian. Okay, I'm not saying first Indian woman, first Indian, okay, in both categories to win two international skiing medals. At the time when she won her first medal, at that time also she was the first Indian to win a medal, an international medal in the skiing tournament. Okay, so I hope that you can now easily understand what this entire news is all about. So it's the time for our GK Factory, and for today I have taken up a very interesting topic, that is Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. So we are going to discuss about that panel in a very brief manner. Okay, first of all, this Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, it has been created by two organizations of UN. First is World Meteorological Organization and the second is UN Environment Program. Okay, now the basic purpose of this IPCC is to tell, is to foretell basically the climate change related phenomena, is to study the science behind the climate change. But guys, one question should be there in your minds, that why did the UN need to create this entirely different organization when it already had WMO and UNEP plus many kinds of international treaties like UNFCCC already in place? So here the right answer is that as far as the World Meteorological Organization is concerned, it deals with the phenomenon related to atmosphere, related to weather. So it just provides the information what is about the status quo, okay, related to the environment. UN Environment Program deals with environment, yes, but the major focus of this organization, or this basically this arm of UN, is to conserve the environment, is to work for the conservation of the environment via different kinds of campaigns, programs, etc. So nobody here is dealing with the science, nobody is researching on the reasons behind the climate change. And for that purpose only IPCC was created, to study the phenomenons, the science behind the climate change. That's the purpose of IPCC. Now there would be one more question in your mind. Why are we studying this? Why is ma'am telling this IPCC in the GK Factory section? So guys, here again, if you understand what IPCC is, you will be better, you will be in a better position to understand the reports that IPCC tells, okay, releases. Because the reports that IPCC releases, and one of the latest reports I have taken towards the end of this session, and we will discuss that report also. So if you understand what is the purpose of this IPCC, then obviously you will be in a better position to understand the report, as well as you can cite some of the facts related to the report in your ESI answers also. Now, related to the IPCC only, the establishment year of IPCC is 1988. Its secretariat is located at the headquarters of WMO, which is in Geneva, Switzerland. Okay. So, as I told you, that IPCC provides the scientific basis for the governments at all levels to develop climate-related policies. Okay. Nobody, until the formation of IPCC, no organization, no conference, no international treaty was working towards researching the phenomena, researching the reasons. This came up and this provided the data to the governments. Now, if the data is available, only then the governments or the policymakers can create the right kind of policies to tackle the climate change or any kind of issue per se. Okay. And the assessments of the IPCC basically prepared the groundwork for discussions at the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. Even now, the reports of the IPCC, those reports basically provides the groundwork, provides the base for many governments, for many policymakers to create a framework, to create their proposal to be put at the UNFCCC's COP. Okay. IPCC has provided a range of reports like methodology reports, special reports, technical reports. As and when the governments or the UNFCCC or any kind of international organization has asked for it. Okay, so IPCC is doing a marvelous job, and in recognition of its job, the Nobel Prize was also given to IPCC in the year 2007. Now, guys, this is a very extra fact, I should say. You don't need to memorize it. Even I should say that you don't need to memorize any point till now that I have told you, except for the year of formation of IPCC as and the headquarters of IPCC. These are the two facts where you need to cram your mind. Otherwise, all of these are very basic points. Okay, so okay, I already told you that you don't need to memorize it, but still I'll tell you, IPCC got the Nobel Prize with US Vice President Al Gore for its work towards climate change. Now let's have a look at the structure of IPCC as well. Okay, because if for any kind of international organization, if you understand the basic structure of the organization, it becomes easier, a bit easier. However, you don't need to memorize it. Okay, again and again, I'm repeating this thing because I have seen some of the students start mugging up the facts that I provide. You don't need to mug up them. You just need to understand them. And if you understand, develop the conceptual base, then I think it will be easier for you to retain things for a longer period of time. So first is the IPCC plenary. Now guys, the name, Intergovernmental Panel. So obviously many governments are involved. So this plenary is basically a session of the governments or the international organizations which are the members of IPCC. On that note, can you guys tell me how many countries are members of IPCC? Because this is the fact that I have kept for you all. Okay, so this is your homework. Do it and mention it in the comment section below. So it's the government intergovernmental panel that meets and it elects the Bureau of Scientists. Okay, so this bureau then elects experts that basically prepare the reports. IPCC is known for its reports. Therefore, the most important part is played by the executive committee, that is the committee of experts. And the report is prepared with the help of these groups. Okay, so working group one. And now these are the permanent groups of IPCC. Okay, and the members can change, but the structure will remain the same. So the first group undertakes the research on the physical science basis, okay, the reasons behind the change in the topography, etc., etc., whatever are the features in the physical geography or the physical earth. So that is studied by this working group one. Working group two studies the impact, the adaptation by the people and the environment and the vulnerability. of the climate change. Working group 3 studies the mitigation of the climate change, the ways to mitigate. Task force on national greenhouse inventories. So it basically, from the name itself, it's evident that it is going to study the GHG emissions and its impact on the environment. Last is the contribution by the authors, contributors and reviewers. So that's the basic structure. Now again, this is a very extra fact, extra slide that I have put here, but since we are discussing IPCC, so it's our duty to go in a bit of depth to understand it completely. So this is just the structure that we have studied here, okay? So you don't need to go into this, but yes, I have just put an extra thing here that is telling you the locations of the working groups. So first location is the IPCC Secretariat that I have already told you is at the headquarters of WMO. The working group first is located in France at this university. Working group 2 is located at this institute in Germany. 3 is located at this institute in UK. And the task force on national greenhouse inventories is located at this institution in Japan. So the basic motive behind putting this here is to tell you how different countries are the stakeholders are contributing towards the reports and climate change in general. Okay. So as I told you that I have taken the very latest report of IPCC for discussion towards the end of the session. So here it is. This is, guys, the 6th assessment report. Okay. So if you remember the structure of IPCC, that first is the plenary session, then the executive bureau, then the bureau, then the executive committee. So the bureau, the members of the bureau are chosen by the plenary for a particular assessment period. Okay, and because of that assessment period, the reports that are released by those experts are known as the assessment reports. So the latest one is the 6th assessment report released by IPCC. The title of the report is Climate Change, the Physical Science Basis. Okay, now let's have a look at the facts. But I hope that you are a regular follower of the Daily Current Affairs. So you must have done it at the time of its release also. August mein nikli thi, I covered it in Daily Current Affairs. And if you haven't seen it, it's okay. Yahan kar lo. Okay, so for the first time, IPCC through this report paid attention to the regions as well. Okay, it did not just have a very panopticon view and covered the entire globe in just one way. It had focused on different regions. A total of 11 regions were there which were in focus in this report. Okay, as per this report, it says kitna bhi edi choti ka zor laga lo, kuch nahi hone wala. Climate change is imminent and the global temperature will rise by 1.5 degrees Celsius by 2040. Okay, so that's the crux of this report. That kuch bhi kar lo, itna to badhkar hi rahega. So currently the global average temperature is 1.1 degrees Celsius and a further rise of 0.4 degrees Celsius may lead to heat waves. Okay, may lead to longer warm seasons and shorter cold seasons, may also lead to sea level rise, uneven rainfalls, etc., etc. Globally, coastal areas will see continuous sea level rise and throughout the 21st century, as far as the facts are concerned, so by the year 2015, the sea level rise per year was 3 to 4 mm. But by the year 2100, the completion of this century, the sea level rise would be 3 to 8 mm. So this is definitely going to submerge many of the coastal regions. UN Secretary has also said that this report is the code red for humanity. High time that the industry, that the people, that the governments should wake up to the climate change and take it seriously. And many of them have taken it. Again, I will repeat, Panch Mitra. That the India has given at COP26 of UNFCCC are very important. Even though there would not be a question directly on them, but still they are very, very important, very useful. If there is a question on India's policies towards climate change, you can cite them. So prepare them thoroughly. Okay, so this is the picture that tells about the global scenario. So the planet will warm up by 1.5 degrees Celsius in the next two decades by 2040 over the pre-industrial level. This is the pre-industrial level that is being compared to the year 2040, the coming next decades. The most emissions pathway, even in the most ambitious emissions pathway, it will overshoot to 1.6 degrees Celsius before temperature declines to 1.4 degrees Celsius at the end of the century. So what this point is saying, that whatever you do, even if the most ambitious climate plan you have, the entire globe's temperature is going to overshoot to 1.6 degrees Celsius. And after reaching this level, it will definitely come down to 1.4 degrees Celsius. But for that, you have to wait for too long, by the end of this century. Under the existing emissions trajectory, it will be on track for global average temperature rise of at least 2.7 degrees Celsius by 2100. So this is basically the global emission trajectory that this report is telling us. Now here you can see the temperature rise. Again, you don't have to go into the details of this and try to understand this. Nobody is going to ask you this in your RBI 7 about examination. Even for UPSC also, even if we take the example of the very zenith level of examination, then also this entire thing is useless. Nobody is going to ask this. Okay, what this report says about India, or what this climate change mean for India. The country is expected to see an increase in frequent and severe hot waves, heat waves or hot extremes. Incidents of forest fire will go up. Rainfall will become more severe in the southern parts of India. Rain could also increase 20% in the southwest coast compared to 1850 to 1900 level. Now here this portion talks about the South Asian region. So monsoon precipitation is expected to go up in the mid to long term over the South Asian region. This can increase the occurrence of glacial lake outburst, flood and landslides over moraine dammed lakes. Okay, monsoon is going to increase, basically rainfall is going to increase in the South Asian region. The increased temperature will lead to the glacial lake outburst. I hope that you already know what this glacial lake outburst is. If you don't know, then it's basically the part of the glacial lake that melts and then it comes to the plains in the form of flood. Okay, the similar phenomenon that happened in Uttarakhand. Okay, floods and landslides. So this is also there. Snow line elevations will rise and glacier volumes will decline. Obviously, glaciers will decline. Regional mean sea level in South Asia will continue to rise. So all of these are very basic points. Now here, very important fact, don't try to mug up this all. You will just mess all the things, because this is not required from you, even if you are appearing for ESI also. Okay, so don't try to cram this up. But yes, this is important. Here is a fact, you can memorize this, and these are very basic things that you can create on your own as well. Okay, so here the session ends. I hope that you have found it useful, and if you have found it really useful, then do subscribe the channel, hit the bell notification, like this video and share it among your friends. Thank you so much for watching the video.